Namaskar, good afternoon, and a very warm welcome to this special briefing on Prime Minister's three-country visit to Palestine, UAE and Oman from 9th to 12th February 2018. We had issued a press release earlier, and I'm sure you must have seen that press release, spelling out broad contours of the program and also of the visit. Today I have with me Joint Secretary Gulf, Sri Mridul Kumar, as well as Joint Secretary West and North Africa, Sri B. Bhalabhaskar, to share more details of the program, elements, and also the highlights of the visit of the Prime Minister to these three countries. But before I hand over to the two Joint Secretaries, I thought I would like to just run through some of the broad common elements which exists in this visit. First, this visit has to be seen against the backdrop of the hectic diplomatic engagement which we had in the last few weeks. I'm sure you all must have seen the very successful visit of 10 ASEAN leaders to India for the ASEAN-India Community Summit. External Affairs Minister is visiting Saudi Arabia tomorrow from 6th to 8th. We are therefore looking at this visit from the extended neighborhood. We are seeing it not only from the land perspective, not from the neighborhood, from the land point of view, but also from a maritime perspective, the extended neighborhood from a maritime perspective. Second, Prime Minister's visit is being undertaken as part of a larger exercise to fulfill the government's domestic and international agenda, and also to bring some benefit to the people on the ground, to the common people. And I think there are certain elements in the program where there will be direct benefit to the people. Thirdly, India, of course, we are very proud of our diaspora abroad, but our effort during this visit and also earlier visits is to broad base our engagement with these countries into moving towards a more strategic sphere, both on trade and investment, as well as on defense and security. With these opening remarks, I would now like to give the floor to Sri B. Bhalabhaskar, Joint Secretary Wana. He will touch upon PM's visit to Palestine, and after that, Mridul will be talking about Prime Minister's visit to UAE and Oman. And after the two briefings, we will have questions from the floor. This briefing is only for Prime Minister's visit to the three countries. It is not a regular briefing. Thank you.
Thank you. Good afternoon, friends. As you are aware, you know, PM is undertaking his first ever historic visit to Palestine. He will be going to Ramallah on 10th of February. First, before formal talks, he would be visiting Yasser Arafat's museum. He will be paying tribute and wreath-laying ceremony there in the honor of a departed leader. Then he will hold official talks with Palestinian leadership. And then from he will be then there will be joint press, and then after that they will be hosting a banquet lunch. After that, he will be returning to Oman, and from there he will be going to the other parts of the world, his trip. You know, as you are aware, for last 3 years we have made significant and positive contributions for the Palestinian cause. Starting from 2015, where our President Rashtrapati undertook first ever historic visit to Palestine, followed by External Affairs Minister's visit, and then President Abbas visited India in May 2017. Our Prime Minister met President Abbas in 2015 on the sidelines of UNGA, again on the sidelines of Paris meet. This will be fourth meeting of PM of President Abbas. And then to deepen our engagement, we have undertaken first ever historic joint commission meeting, a ministerial level joint commission meeting with Palestine in November 2016. We have agreed to deepen our engagement into several areas, including health, IT, and then tourism, youth affairs, sports, agriculture, all these areas. When President Abbas came, we have also signed several agreements to further deepen our engagement. And then when Rashtrapati went to, that is on the political level and the exchanges point of view, when President visited Ramallah, you know, our contribution to Palestinian cause is threefold. One is at the political level. The other one is our contribution to the nation building process, their infrastructure, capacity building, and then other project assistances we have been doing. When President visited Palestine, we have commenced projects worth $30 million. And one of the signature projects of his visit is the building of ICT Park, India-Palestine ICT Park in Palestine, which has been under construction. That will create large-scale employment and also connect Palestinian IT industry with the Indian IT industry. Then after that, for the Palestinian cause, we have taken significant steps. Apart from our regular support at various international fora, you are aware that in December 2017, we have voted in favor of a very, very important resolution on Jerusalem. And then before that, we also contributed for the accession of Palestine into Interpol, which will have a very important benefits to the Palestinian side. And so this visit is part of that enhanced engagement, as JSXP mentioned, that also to secure our interest, both from the domestic perspective and also international perspective. We have also important engagement to Palestinian side on the security area. I think this is a standalone visit. You are aware that we have dehyphenated our relations with Palestine and Israel. Now we see them, though, are mutually independent and exclusive. And as part of this policy, Prime Minister is undertaking this visit. So thank you so much.
Now I would request JS Gulf to brief the media on Prime Minister's visit to UAE and Oman.
Thank you, Ravish. Prime Minister is traveling to UAE and Oman from 10th to 12th of February. From Palestine, he will reach UAE late in the evening on 10th of February. You are all aware that this visit is primarily at the invitation of the President of UAE, Sheikh Khalifa bin Zayed Al Nahyan. And the President wrote about Prime Minister's participation in the 6th World Government Summit, which is happening in Dubai. And in addition to that plural multilateral arrangement, Prime Minister is also going to have a state visit to UAE. You're all aware that in the last 2.5 years, since Prime Minister first went to UAE in August 2015, there has been a huge intensification of our engagement with UAE. Prime Minister's visit took place after almost 34 years rather. And in the last 2.5 years, we had seen 4 high-level head of government visits between UAE and India. After he went there in February 2016, the Crown Prince of Abu Dhabi came here. Soon after that, in January 2017, he again visited India as the chief guest for our Republic Day. So there has been a huge intensification in our engagement with UAE. And as JSXP mentioned earlier, that this intensification is beyond our engagement with the diaspora. Before I talk about the larger, the nitty-gritties of the visit, I'll give you a very broad picture of what is envisaged in our engagement with the Gulf. Gulf accounts for, the 6 GCC countries account for almost 20% of our bilateral trade. And by far, they are the largest trading regional blocks for us. About $110 billion of trade. And out of that, oil is a very small portion. A lot of people might think that oil is a major portion, but it's not. If you are looking at the other aspects, for example, the energy, they are our key source of energy. 50% of our oil comes from these countries. Almost 60-65% of our LNG requirements are sourced from Gulf. Beyond the buyer-seller engagement, we have now moved into the strategic sphere in terms of our energy security, which I will talk to you about. And then if you look at the Indian diaspora, it's now 9 million strong and growing. And the amount of money that they send back home is about $35 billion annual, which sustain about millions of families back home. The new areas that we have been working upon in the last 2.5 years include defense and security. And we have made tremendous progress on that. And finally, and the most important of it is the economic content of our engagement. If you look at UAE, for example, when Prime Minister went in August 2015, there was an agreement that we will have $75 billion of UAE investment in India. And UAE has done a lot in the last few years in terms of meeting our requirement of FDIs, which are so very essential to look at the larger developmental goals that the current government has. And good part is that this investment is not going into frivolous areas. This is going into hardcore infrastructure areas, areas which are very critical to not only the development of the country, but also to making sure that these developmental fruits are passed on to individuals who are at the bottom of our society. So like, for example, I must mention that we had about $500 million of UAE investment committed in low-cost housing projects in India, very recent. You might have heard of, I think most of you must have written on those articles, that DP World has put in $3 billion, $1 billion already put in, and $2 billion committed. And they are looking at ports, they are looking at logistic chains, they are looking at food parks. So all these areas are very critical to what the current government is doing in terms of developing the nation and taking it forward for a very comprehensive development of our people. Now, when Prime Minister reaches Abu Dhabi on 10th of February, late in the evening from Palestine, he will be hosted by His Highness the Crown Prince of Abu Dhabi, Sheikh Mohammed bin Zayed Al Nahyan. There will be bilateral discussions with him, and usual exchange of agreements, signing of agreements will take place. We have a good, nice array of agreements. You are aware that in the past two visits, 2016 February and January 2017, we had signed 24 agreements with UAE. And one of the agreement was Comprehensive Strategic Partnership Agreement. And our engagement now is in the context of that agreement that we had signed with them. So after that, there'll be a banquet His Highness will be hosting in the honor of our Prime Minister. Next morning, Prime Minister will travel to Wahat al-Karama. Now, Wahat al-Karama is a memorial that UAE has very recently made in tribute to martyred UAE soldiers. In 1971, in the First War, on Tun Island, there was one chap by the name Salem who passed on. And it is in his memory and the memory of the other UAE soldiers who passed on in those military actions, they have created this. So Prime Minister will be paying a visit to that. After that, he will be having a community event. Now, as a part of the community event, it's not a very regular community event he's hosting. As a part of this community engagement, he will be meeting with the top professionals and other members of the community who are making sure that their host country gets the benefit of their hard work, as much as we are getting the benefit of their remittances back home. But in that community event, there is a very special event that we are also planning, and that will be laying of the foundation stone for the Hindu temple. You might recall that when Prime Minister went there was a huge demand from our community in terms of starting a temple in Abu Dhabi. So at that point in time, His Highness was very categorical, and he said that, yes, I will definitely look after that demand. And he promised, and this promise has come to fruition. And there'll be foundation stone, and very shortly, the commencement of the construction of that temple will begin. So after this, there will be this major event, which I talked about, the Sixth World Government Summit, in which India has been taken as a guest of honor country. Last year it was US, Japan, and before that it was US. So this year Prime Minister is going, and he's speaking on a very special subject. He's speaking on technology for development, which is a very dear theme of him. And this provides us a platform of engaging with the world community again soon after he has been to Davos, in terms of providing the world as to what is this government's vision in terms of bringing in technology for the development of the nation and its people. So that event will take place, and he will make a keynote address in the World Government Summit. That event will be taking place in Dubai, and obviously when you are in Dubai, Prime Minister will meet with the ruler of Dubai, who happens to be the Vice President and the Prime Minister of UAE also. So after that event, Prime Minister will meet with very select CEOs from the Gulf and Gulf countries. So there'll be huge CEOs from Saudi Arabia, Kuwait, UAE, etc. And this will provide us another platform in which we can tell them about the possibilities of greater investments in our country. And then, if you are looking at the broad framework of our engagement with UAE, I think we have moved very strongly on not only the energy. You are aware that last year we had, during the visit of His Highness the Crown Prince, an agreement signed on their participation in ISPRL, which is our strategic oil reserve. So this this is the first country, and the kind of platform that they have created will provide us a model for working out similar arrangements with other countries, whereby we will invite strategic participation in our strategic oil reserves. UAE, by the way, has also become our first partner in the NIIF. You know that, again, this agreement was signed in January 2017, and it came to fruition in October when the ADIA, Abu Dhabi Investment Agency, invested $1 billion as anchor investor in NIIF. And after that, not only they have become a partner of us in terms of infrastructure development through NIIF, but also they are encouraging other private investors, as well as other sovereign wealth funds in UAE, for example, Mubadala, ADIC. So they are also coming up along with ADIA in various infrastructure development plans of ours. And I can give you the details if you need to ask me that question. So if you are looking at a very broad framework of what we have achieved in the past 2 years, the comprehensive strategic partnership has now actually become a real comprehensive strategic partnership in all senses of the world. Now I'll brief you about what Prime Minister is going to do in Oman. From Dubai, after the meeting with CEOs, they will travel to Oman. And there'll be a ceremonial reception at the airport. And then he will straight away go in for a community event. It'll be a very large, big community event. For first time he's traveling to Oman. You are aware that Oman is a very important strategic partner of ours. Our prime ministers have been visiting Oman on a regular basis. His Majesty Sultan Qaboos has also visited us some time back. So after this community event, which will take place in a big stadium in Muscat, he will go for a meeting with His Majesty Sultan Qaboos, and there'll be a special dinner hosted by Sultan Qaboos in honor of the Prime Minister. Next day, on 12th of February, he will have a meeting with the Omani CEOs, again on the pattern that we are discussing with regard to World Government Summit. There is a big mosque, Sultan Qaboos Grand Mosque, which is very grand and very majestic mosque. And he will be paying a visit to that mosque in the afternoon. Prime Minister will also visit a Shiva temple there. And in addition to these visits, he will also be meeting with the two deputy prime ministers. One is Sayyid Fahad, and the other one is Sayyid Asad. So both these deputy prime ministers he will be meeting with, and soon after that he'll be coming back. Now, if you're looking at Oman, if you look at the map, Oman is practically our next door neighbor. We reach Oman earlier than we reach Kerala. And if you look at the location again, it's located at a very important geostrategic place. So there is a lot we have done with Oman in the past several years. Our defense cooperation is a sui generis defense cooperation, one of its kind in the entire Gulf countries. Omanis, we conduct all three exercises with our forces, Army, Navy, and Air Force. Last year we did it in January, and up to December we had these exercises. You know that Oman provides OTR facilities to our ships. Last 2 years we had over 50 ships traveling there on OTR jobs. Very, very important, Salalah is the port which provides that facility to us. And also our planes which are traveling further up in the west, they get refueling facility in Oman on a regular basis. So if you look at the strategic dimension of our engagement with Oman, it's very important. And keeping in view that very critical aspect of our defense and security arrangement, Prime Minister is going there. You must also be knowing that when Father Tom was released, it was at the intervention of the Omani authorities that we got him released from Yemen. So with these words, I leave the floor open to questions, and JSXPM wish to say a few words.
Thank you, Mridul. Now the floor is open to questions. Siddhant.
So how much will be counter-terror the focus during Prime Minister's visit to the countries, all three countries?
Maybe I can request Mridul to answer this question.
You are aware that terrorism has been a common cause of common concern for India and our Gulf partners. If you look at our joint statements in the past four visits, it has come out very clearly and very explicitly. And there is no doubt that we have a very strong agency-to-agency, a cooperation with them. Our people are discussing on a very regular basis, and it's not only with UAE, with Oman, with Qatar, with Saudi Arabia, irrespective. So counter-terrorism is definitely going to be a very important aspect of our discussions with the counterpart leaderships in these countries.
As far as Palestine is concerned, Palestine also is a very important partner in our fight against terrorism. They extend total support to us, and we have very good say, as I mentioned in the earlier, we had a very good security cooperation with the Palestinian side. And sitting in that part of the world, they have very good experience in this arena. So one of the key areas of our bilateral engagement is also cooperation in security and counter-terrorism strategies.
Vinita, and then Elizabeth.
My question is for J.S. Bhaskar. External Affairs Minister last year in a press statement, she made a statement that, you know, Palestine wants India to use its good relations with to build the bridges between the two countries. So has India taken any steps to resolve the dispute between the countries?
There are several international initiatives are taking place for that issue. And I think we want this initiative to take shape, and then we have focus on deepening reiterating our support to Palestinian cause wherever it is, and then deepening our engagement bilaterally. We have been making very active contribution in the Palestinian nation building, infrastructure, capacity building, scholarships, and the education sector. So as of now, we are focusing more on that. Thank you.
Elizabeth.
Mr. Kumar, I was wondering about the legacy issues which are there in the investment area with the UAE. I believe there has been some kind of agreement, or we are near some kind of agreement where DP World is concerned. But what happens to MR and Etisalat and the other legacy issues? You also said you could give us some details about the NIIF investments, Mubadala Group, etc., etc. So could you give us some?
Thank you. If you look at the legacy issue, there are two kinds of issues that we are dealing with. One is the issues like MR and Etisalat, which are sub judice. And then there is another set of issues which are kind of more bureaucratic, administrative, financial. Now, in the last 2.5 years, you are aware that we have an institutional mechanism, which is called the High Level Task Force on Investment. And from our side, it's chaired by the Commerce Minister. So very recently, on 14th of January, Commerce Minister went to UAE. And he mentioned that many of the issues which are pertaining to administrative matters, bureaucracy, finances, etc., have been resolved. For example, TAKA, their investment in Himachal Pradesh, and some of the DP World. Obviously, DP World will not invest $3 billion without getting a comfort on the issues that they were facing. So most of the DP World issues have also been addressed. But you will definitely agree with me that the issues which are sub judice, there are mechanisms for them to be dealt with. In terms of their investment in us, there is, in the last 1 year, a broad, about $4 billion of FDI, direct investment, as also commitments, which are firm commitments. And these range, as I mentioned earlier, from the low-cost housing to renewable forms of energy. Greenco, they have invested some money in. HDFC. Then there are various banks which are providing certain funds for putting money into infrastructure. So like, for example, Kotak Mahindra Bank, HDFC, etc. $1 billion each has also been sent in those funds, through which investments options will be explored on behalf of the UAE side. So, and again, if you're looking at railways, for example, five railway station modernization program under Shapurji Palanji, DP World, logistics, food chains, ports, inland waterways. Sharaf Group is talking about, again, food parks, etc. So there's a lot which is happening. In addition to that, we are also looking at about $5 to $6 billion of UAE investment in portfolios. So, and I also mentioned to you that it's not only the investment in FDI, but when you're talking about somebody coming for the first time in an institution like NIF, what is, and by the way, ADI is one of the finest and most professionally run investment authority on the planet. So when ADI does this due diligence with us, then we can go to any other agency and say that, look, some of the best have done business with us, why can't you? So they have given us a template in terms of our making it easier to get the other sovereign wealth funds from across the world. Similarly, when you look at, for example, the Strategic Oil Reserve, they are the first ones. So the agreement that we have carved out with them forms a template for us to deal with the other countries in terms of doing the same thing.
Mic, otherwise it won't be recorded. Just hold on.
So you said $4 billion FDI in commitments, as well as, I mean, that's the figure that you gave first. And then you said another $4 to $5 billion FIIs?
Yeah. I said portfolios. Yes. So there are two kinds. One is the FDI, one is the portfolio.
Right. So is this expected this year?
Already there in the markets. Can't you see the buoyancy in the market?
The gentleman in the second row. No, I think here. He requested first.
Yeah. This is Dr. Awad speaking. Sir, I just wanted to highlight the question, Mr. Kumar, on the issue of the rising insecurity in the Persian Gulf and the continuous war on Yemen have threatened the peace and security in the region. I just wanted to know if India would like to have any assessment on the security issue there, or would like to play a major role as a stabilizing factor in this part of the world, because the Red Sea has been threatening, the Persian Gulf is threatening, it's threatening the global trade and as well as the oil transport from that side. Thank you.
I thought it was PM's visit. Briefing.
That's a part of the Indian assessment of the situation there.
I think we will keep that for the next briefing, but please confine your question, limit your questions to Prime Minister's visit. Ranjit ji, and then Pranay, and then Mr. Venkat.
What is India's stand on East Jerusalem?
I think you are aware that we have voted, there was a UNGA resolution in December 21st. We have voted in favor of resolution. So, on Jerusalem.
No, that is different. East Jerusalem I am talking about.
No, yeah, that's what I am saying. We have voted in favor of UNGA resolution on Jerusalem on 21st December. So our position has been very clear, consistent, independent, and there is no any change on our position on Palestinian issue.
The future capital of Palestine.
Rajit ji, I think whatever on this issue, I think I have also shared India's position. It has been shared by Bala as well. So I think that is what we have to share at this stage. Pranay?
Sir, UAE ke saath counter-terror cooperation mein बहुत बड़ा मुद्दा रहा है कि भारत के जो अपराधी हैं वो भाग के दुबई और अन्य जगहों पे अपने ठिकाने बनाते हैं और वहाँ से वो ऑपरेट करते रहते हैं. प्रधानमंत्री, खासतौर पर दाऊद इब्राहिम के जो प्रॉपर्टीज़ हैं या इस तरह के जो मुद्दे हैं कि आगे भारत के जो अपराधी हैं भाग कर वहाँ पनाह ले पाएँ, इस पर क्या कॉन्क्रीट मेजर का कोई प्रपोजल हम लेके जा रहे हैं वहाँ पर, या क्या इस पर किसी प्रगति की कोई उम्मीद आप कर रहे हैं? क्योंकि पिछले साल ऐसा रिपोर्ट्स आई थी कि यूएई ने क्रैकडाउन किया है, लेकिन यूएई के एम्बेसडर ने उसे डिनाई भी किया था कि कोई प्रॉपर्टी सीज नहीं हुई. तो क्या कुछ हुआ है एक्शन?
देखिए, जो काउंटर टेररिज्म का मुद्दा है, ये कंटिन्यूस प्रोसेस है. ऐसा नहीं है कि आपने एक जर्क से काम शुरू कर दिया. पिछले 2.5 सालों में अमूमन इस पर बहुत काम हुआ है. और काउंटर टेररिज्म एक ऐसा मुद्दा नहीं है जिसमें सिर्फ एक यूएई इंडिया करेगा या सऊदी यूएई इंडिया करेगा. सभी मुल्कों के साथ खाड़ी के, जहाँ पर हमारी ये चिंताएँ रही हैं जैसे आपने बताया, उन सभी देशों के साथ हमारे इन इन बातों पर गंभीर विचार हो रहा है. और मैं आपके साथ इन्फॉर्मेशन तो ज़्यादा शेयर नहीं कर सकता, बट मैं आपको ये ज़रूर बताना चाहूँगा कि हमारी एजेंसियाँ बहुत ही रेगुलर बेसिस पर एक दूसरे के साथ इन मुद्दों पर बातचीत भी करती हैं. और बहुत सारे ऐसे तत्व जो हम भारत के हितों के खिलाफ तथा हमारे ऐसे और मित्र देश जैसे यूएई है या सऊदी अरब है, उनके हितों के खिलाफ जो काम करते हैं, उनको हम मिलकर न्यूट्रलाइज करने की कोशिश करा करते हैं. बहुत सारी खबरें आपको अखबारों के माध्यम से पास में मिली होंगी, मैं उनके ऊपर कोई टिप्पणी देना मुनासिब नहीं समझूंगा.
मिस्टर वेंकट,
कैन यू एक्सपैंड ऑन दिस इंडियाज स्ट्रेटेजिक ऑयल रिजर्व्स? व्हाट एग्जैक्टली इज द क्वांटिटी ऑफ द रिजर्व्स गोइंग टू बी? वेयर एग्जैक्टली आर वी गोइंग टू बिल्ड दिस अंडरग्राउंड फैसिलिटीज? एंड हाउ मच ऑयल फ्रॉम विच कंट्री इज गोइंग टू बी कंट्रीब्यूटेड टू दिस? थैंक्स.
If you look at UAE, for example, and I'm not going to talk about other countries, because I mentioned to you that UAE is the first country which has participated in our oil reserve program. We are looking at about 5.86 million barrels of oil, which should be at present rate of oil per barrel, about $300 million. Now, we have got these caverns already made. And one of the caverns that is being filled in with the first lot of oil from UAE will be at Pudur in Mangalore.
Smita and then Sanjeev.
Smita Sharma from the Tribune. Mr. Kumar, the Qatari defense minister recently in an interview said that UAE and Saudi, which have also announced a military alliance outside of the GCC ambit, were planning to invade, which has been diffused at the moment. But given the GCC turmoil, how much of a concern is it for India with its diaspora there, the sizable remittances? Is that going to figure in talks with the UAE top leadership? And either Mr. Bhaskar or Ravish, you could answer. In the recent row with the Palestinians, when their ambassador was recalled from Pakistan, the Palestinian argument was that they had shared stage with Hafez Saeed only because it was a rally on the Israel-US-Jerusalem issue, and that's why the intention must not be questioned. Is that issue well addressed now? Is that still a concern?
Mridul, you take first.
Thank you for this question. I was thinking of saying no to this because this is out of the Prime Minister's visit, but you exactly, I'm going to talk about it, don't worry. But I think you made a very valid point. Obviously, as Bala Bhaskar also pointed out earlier, our relationship with all these countries are extremely important. First of all, I outlined the major stakes. Now, if somebody is providing you 65% of your energy and 50% of your oil and $35 billion of remittances and 20% of your bilateral trade, you will be concerned that any problem which arises in that area might affect all these vital stakes adversely. But please advise me if I'm telling you that both from UAE and from Qatar and from Saudi Arabia, I'm getting this comfort that all of them talk about our forward-looking engagement with them. They're all appreciative of the stand we have taken with regard to our bilateral engagement with them. We have not spoken about the intra-regional rivalries. And I think the policy that we have adopted under the wise leadership of Prime Minister has been not only well appreciated, it has worked very well. And the results are in front of you. I mean, I don't need to expand beyond what I have said earlier. But when I came in this job 5 years ago, we had 6 million Indians living in Gulf. Today, I'm talking about 9 million plus. So we have more than 1.5 times increased our numbers there. If there is a challenge with regard to our diaspora's comfort, well-being, welfare, obviously these numbers will not increase. So irrespective of how the regional situation is developing, I think we have been able to insulate our vital stakes very well from any adverse possible effect.
Yeah. Let me answer the second part of your question. As you are aware, you know, the Palestinian side made it very, very clear that whatever was the reason, his sharing of Dias with Hafiz Saeed was unacceptable to Palestinian authorities, and within no time they recalled him. So I think we don't need to see any more, read anything into that. And the fact that they acted so promptly and they issued a written statement and they said that it was not acceptable speaks volumes of their trust and relationship with India. Sanjeev.
जैसा कि आपने बताया कि प्रधानमंत्री के यात्रा कार्यक्रम में शिव मंदिर जाने का कार्यक्रम है मस्कट में और इसके अलावा अबू धाबी में भी टेंपल से जुड़ा हुआ एक कार्यक्रम है क्या इसके बारे में कुछ और विशेष जानकारी हमें देना चाहेंगे क्या अबू धाबी में होने जा रहा है प्रधानमंत्री वहां मौजूद होंगे क्या कुछ जानकारी
देखिए जहां तक प्रधानमंत्री के इन स्थानों पर जाने का ताल्लुक है मैंने यूएई के बारे में आपको बताया था कि वो टेंपल में नहीं जा रहे हैं वो एक इंडियन कम्युनिटी के इवेंट में टेंपल का वीडियो लिंक के द्वारा फाउंडेशन स्टोन ले करेंगे और उस समय कुछ जो वहाँ पर टेंपल कमेटी के मेंबरान हैं वो वहाँ पर पहुँचे होंगे उनको कुछ जो प्रपोज टेंपल है उसकी कुछ फोटोग्राफ बनाकर वो उनको भेंट की जाएंगी तो ये कोई टेंपल में विजिट नहीं है ये जो कमिटमेंट यूएई की सरकार द्वारा कुछ समय पहले हमारे प्रधानमंत्री जी को दिया गया था टू लुक आफ्टर द इंटरेस्ट एंड द डिमांड ऑफ द इंडियन कम्युनिटी लिविंग इन यूएई ये उसका परिपालन है ये उसकी परिपाटी है जो पूरी की जा रही है जहाँ तक कि ओमान में उनके इन जगहों पे जाने का ताल्लुक है जैसे कि मैंने आपको बताया वो जो एक बहुत खूबसूरत वहाँ पर बहुत बड़ी मॉस्क है आप बड़ी आसानी से उसको गूगल करके पता लगा सकते हैं सुल्तान काबूस की मॉस्क है और कहते हैं कि वहाँ पर एक टाइम पर सबसे लंबा दुनिया का कारपेट वहाँ पर अनडिवाइडेड कारपेट वहाँ लगा हुआ है तो उस मॉस्क में जाएंगे वहाँ पर देखेंगे मॉस्क को और इसी के साथ ही हमारी आप ये शायद भूल रहे हैं कि ओमान में जो हमारी हिंदुस्तानी कम्युनिटी है उसको अपने रिलीजियस फेथ अपने बिलीफ को पालन करने के लिए पूरी आज़ादी है ओमान हुआ बहरीन हुआ अब आप यूएई देखिए अगेन मुस्लिम देश है लेकिन फिर भी उन्होंने इस बात की इजाज़त दे दी है तो ओमान में जो टेंपल है बहुत पुराना टेंपल है प्राचीन टेंपल है और भारतीय कम्युनिटी की ये गुजारिश थी उसी गुजारिश को पालन करते हुए पूरा करते हुए प्रधानमंत्री जी शिव मंदिर में जाएंगे
सर मेरा सवाल भी फाउंडेशन स्टोन से ही जुड़ा हुआ है बेसिकली जो पीएम का पूरा प्रोग्राम होगा दरअसल इस फाउंडेशन स्टोन को लेकर जो कि टेंपल का है उसका डिटेल एक बार शेयर करेंगे
वो डिटेल्स अभी उस पर काम चल रहा है और प्रधानमंत्री जी करीब एक घंटा 50 मिनट के करीब हिंदुस्तान की कम्युनिटी से यूएई में बात करेंगे और उसी कम्युनिटी इवेंट के दौरान एक ये जो पक्ष है टेंपल का वो भी निकल के आएगा तो उसमें डिटेल्स हैं मैंने आपको कुछ डिटेल्स तो बताई दी हैं कि वो वीडियो लिंक के द्वारा इसको इनॉग्रेट करेंगे टेंपल फाउंडेशन स्टोन को ले करेंगे उसके अलावा किताब वहाँ पर भेंट की जाएगी जो टेंपल कमेटी के मेंबरान हैं तो बहुत छोटा ये करीब 4-5 मिनट का एक बीच में हमने एलिमेंट डाला है उस बड़े लार्जर इवेंट में और इसको आपको कम्युनिटी की डिमांड के परिप्रेक्ष्य में ही देखना चाहिए
सर ये टेम्पल किस टाइप का है बेसिकली क्या साइज होगा कितने लोग उसमें वर्शिप कर पाएंगे इसका कुछ आइडिया डिटेल मिल पाए
मैं बताऊं,
यस यू आर राइट, मैंने आपको जैसे पहले भी बताया कि ये हालांकि मुसलमान देश है, मुस्लिम देश है, लेकिन भारतीय समुदाय को अपने फेथ को, अपने बिलीफ को एक्सरसाइज करने के लिए इन लोगों ने इजाज़त दे रखी है। बहरीन में हम गए, 150 साल पुराना मंदिर है। ओमान में आप जाइए, 200 साल पुराना शिव मंदिर है। अब जो यूएई में मंदिर बन रहा है, ये अपने आप में पहली बात भव्य मंदिर है, बहुत भव्य मंदिर है, बहुत बड़ा मंदिर है। और मुझे ऐसा लगता है कि हिंदुस्तान में जितने भी अलग अलग सेक्ट्स के लोग हैं, मैं हिंदू धर्म के अंदर सेक्ट्स की बात कर रहा हूँ, उन सभी सेक्ट्स के लोगों को वहाँ जाकर अपने अपने धर्म का पालन, अपने अपने फेथ का उसमें पालन करने का मौका मिलेगा। तो ये कोई पर्टिकुलर गॉड से एसोसिएटेड टेंपल नहीं है, ये एक, आप ये ऐसे समझिए कि एक विदेशी भूमि पर, जो इस्लामिक भूमि है, उस भूमि पर आपकी हिंदू समुदाय को अपने फेथ को एक्सरसाइज करने के लिए उनके राजा ने जो वचन हमारे प्रधानमंत्री जी को दिया था उसका पालन किया जा रहा है। इस मंदिर को कृपा करके किसी भी नाम से ना जोड़ा जाए।
दूसरी बात, एक चीज़ मैं बता दूं कि जितने भी इसमें प्रोग्राम में एलिमेंट्स हैं उसके ऊपर हम राइटअप शेयर करेंगे। सो इस समय उसको बार बार एक ही चीज़ पूछने से कोई फ़ायदा नहीं है, हम शेयर करेंगे। और विज़िट के पहले हम सब, जैसे हमने पहले भी किया है, हर एक चीज़ों के बारे में हम इन्फॉर्मेशन आपसे शेयर करेंगे। हाँ, सब कुछ लोकेशन
अबुधाबी और दुबई के बीच में एक लैंड मास है, काफ़ी बड़ा, उन्होंने हमारे को उसका भूमि का टुकड़ा दिया है। और ये जो मंदिर बनेगा, ये आप समझ लीजिए यूएई सरकार के मतलब गाइडेंस में और उसमें बनेगा।
अगेन दैट विल कम एज पार्ट ऑफ द नोट विच आई विल सर्कुलेट। यस No, I think we are done with the questions on temple. Yes, please.
Sir, will it be possible to share with us the exact amount received from UAE, excluding the commitments?
आप ये जाने कृपा करके कि जब कोई आदमी या कोई कंपनी या कोई सरकार किसी दूसरे देश में पैसा लगाती है तो उसकी जो इन्फॉर्मेशन होती है क्लासिफाइड इन्फॉर्मेशन होती है। क्यों? क्योंकि उसमें रिटर्न्स की बातें होती हैं, उसमें बिजनेस कॉन्फिडेंशियलिटी की बातें होती हैं। जो मैं आपको एक ब्रॉड फ्रेमवर्क बता रहा हूँ, वो ब्रॉड फ्रेमवर्क कुछ कमिटमेंट्स जो फर्म है, कुछ ऐसी बातें जो ऑलरेडी हमारे FDI में अंदर आ चुकी हैं, और कुछ ऐसे पोर्टफोलियो इन्वेस्टमेंट जो ऑलरेडी हमारी शेयर मार्केट में लग चुके हैं, उनके बारे में मैं जिक्र कर रहा हूँ। लेकिन उससे ज़्यादा डिटेल अगर आप NIF से भी मांगेंगे तो वो भी नहीं दे पाएगा। उसकी वजह बड़ी सिंपल है कि जो इन्वेस्टर है वो अपने इन्वेस्टमेंट को बचा कर रखता है। वो आपको एक ब्रॉड स्ट्रक्चर जरूर बता देगा कि हाँ भाई इस सेक्टर में मैं इतना पैसा लगा रहा हूँ, बट उसकी डिटेल्स वो कभी भी किसी भी आदमी से शेयर नहीं करेगा।
प्लीज गो अहेड।
माय क्वेश्चन इज फॉर मिस्टर भास्कर। यू स्पोक अबाउट सिक्योरिटी कोऑपरेशन बिटवीन इंडिया एंड पैलेस्टाइन, कुड यू एलैबोरेट ऑन दिस? व्हाट काइंड ऑफ सिक्योरिटी कोऑपरेशन इज इट इन द फील्ड ऑफ काउंटर टेररिज्म?
No, first of all, you know, whatever the Palestinians leadership, they are the, they always opposed terrorism at various international fora. And then they are with us and they are carrying a tremendous experience in that part of the area, how the operations of terrorists, what are their intentions, their ideologies, how the networks operate. So all these issues, they will be very, very valuable partner for us in that in developing common challenges of terrorism and developing our own strategies on security. So all these areas, Palestinian authorities are very, very important partner. Thank you.
Any other question? Maybe we can take the last one. Kalol, anybody else? Okay, this is the last question. Yeah.
So the last question on temples. I mean, we know the issues about idol worship in the Arab world. So would there be an idol of a deity in the temple, or is it just a prayer hall?
Again, I would like to emphasize that the temple is being granted at the explicit request of the Indian community living in UAE. The request is primarily for the UAE government to accede to. Prime Minister, looking at the basic welfare, well-being of our communities abroad, has taken up this issue with the UAE government. The structure of the temple, the deities, the idols, the funding, these are all something that the Indian community has to work out with the government of that country. So our job was to make that request official in terms of passing it on behalf of the Indian people. But beyond that, the questions are to be addressed to the UAE government and the Indian community members who have taken lead in terms of making this project successful.
I think it is also important to understand that this also reflects the commitment of the UAE government to tolerance and diversity. Absolutely. I think this is something which we are missing in trying to go in for details. I think that is something which is very significant and should be kept in mind. Okay, maybe one more final question now.
Thank you. I wanted to ask you about that beyond inaugurating the IT park in Palestine. What would be the substance of the PM's visit to Palestine? Sorry if I missed it. I mean, if you just elaborate a little bit.
Our engagement with Palestine, like in four areas. Number one, PM going itself, reiterating our commitment personally to the Palestinian leadership. I mean, our commitment for last 70 years, PM is going there and he is reiterating. And he is expressing solidarity with the Palestinian people directly. That is number one. Number two, we have been continuously participating in the Palestinian nation building and capacity building, infrastructure, and all these projects. So in that, we are working on some more projects. We are working with the Palestinian authorities. We would be announcing some more. We are planning to enter into some 5 to 6 MOUs when our Prime Minister visits Palestine to enter into for further participation in their nation building and infrastructure projects. Then there is a huge bilateral agenda. You know, we have been expanding our relations, starting with the Joint Commission, ministerial level Joint Commission meeting. We have already expanded, I have mentioned to you. So we will be further discussing how to deepen and diversify engagement with the Palestinian side. And the fourth element is that, you know, we have been actively supporting Palestinian cause at various international fora. And then you are aware of that even on 21st December, we have voted in favor of the resolution entered by United Nations General Assembly. And so in these four areas, we are going there and we will be discussing these issues. Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, Mridul and Bala, and thank you all for joining. Please have a good day.